are here to talk about resumes. And today, to help us with that, because I cannot help you with that, will be Valerie Furchi. She is a senior talent acquisition with Blue Cross Blue Shield in Michigan. So welcome. Thank you so much for your time today, Valerie.
Thank you.
All right. So before you get started, just a quick thing, because so many of our students or our guests are current students or recent graduates thereabouts, I always like to ask, where did you go to school and what did you study?
So I went to Eastern Michigan University and I studied merchandising and marketing. Not at all what I'm doing now, but that just goes to show you.
That's exactly why we asked that question, actually. I think it's really important for people to see that careers and paths and trajectories, they're all different. So that's fascinating. Thank you for sharing that. I'll let you take the reins here and drop some serious knowledge on us about how we can craft and create the best resumes possible.
All right, let me get this up and going. Can you see my screen?
Not yet.
Okay. What did it do to me? Hang on.
Technology.
Yeah. Hang on. Let me share my screen first because then, okay. And where did you just go?
I think
there
I
we
have.
Go. Okay. Got it. And we're going to go to slideshow from beginning. All right, can you see it now?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. And just to let you all know, I actually have a sophomore at MSU. So I live this and breathe this with you. So resume writing. Today, what we'll cover, we're going to cover the inside info, what recruiters see about you, writing your resume, finding your fit, communicating must-dos, answering your questions. Inside info, what we want to see. So the relevance. We want you to describe your content and skills gained from courses, not just a list of coursework. So something like demonstrate understanding of communications, concepts such as processing fluency, negativity biases, and cognitive dissonance versus here's the courses that I took. Or for example, if you did any like senior projects or any project group things, put those as experience that you've done. And then make it action oriented. Use your verbs to tell us what you've been doing instead of writing a list of responsibilities. So an example would be being prepared and organized meeting material or prepared and organized meeting materials to ensure team members had the information they needed for quick reference versus responsible for making copies of documents for staff meetings. And then your accomplishments. Talk about the results that you delivered your basis on. Like for example, one support firm implemented a go paperless plan by developing the PDF ebooks for all team meetings, saving the company $4,600 in paper annually printing costs. Saved money by creating ebooks for meetings. Much more exploratory or explanative in the first part. And then professionalism. Highlight your skills and experience. Don't detract from them with stylistic font and fancy graphs. So recruiters, and you'll see a little bit further on, I'll show you, recruiters don't have a lot of time to look at resumes. And on average, I would say any intern position that we put out there, we get about 200 on average applicants per position. And we hire about 160 interns, up to 200 interns annually. So you can only imagine how many resumes recruiters have to go through. So it's very good if you use like bullet format. Be creative, but don't overpower the content. And then don't use the designs on your paper. I know some of the career centers lately, I've seen it a lot, have been saying, put your picture on there, put a creative border or this or that. For some of our applicant tracking systems, they won't accept that. And then your content gets disheveled and recruiter can't easily look through your resume. Ever wonder how recruiter get through hundreds of resumes each week? So this is a kind of infographic to show you hotspots of what we look at and how a resume might look. So if you look on the left, because they wrote it in paragraph form and it's a lot to read through, you see the recruiter, the red spots up at the top, that's about all we get through. So we don't even get through a lot of the content. But on the right, if you see, they put bullet points everywhere. So boom, 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 got it. Boom, boom, got it. So this is about an example of how to write your resume. As you'll see, we have Bruce Wayne, who was the Dark Knight and Batman. You wanna use about 5% of the page to do your content info, 75% to do your experience. As you see, again, bullet points out, key projects, things like that. And then 10 to 15% for education. As an intern, you can put your education at the top also. And then also at the top, you can do either a professional profile or objectives. Like, what do you want to do? Like my daughter, for example, is going into civil engineering, but she wants to do construction project management. So that would be her objective. And then at the bottom, awards, volunteering, membership. Don't put personal things on there though. Like, I like to play golf. I have a dog. Don't do any of that. We want everything to be non-biased objectives. So you may be wondering what we suggest. How many pages should it be? One page is the traditional answer for that, especially if you don't have a lot of experience. But when I hire doctors, for example, they have a lot of experience. So when it's multiple pages for a doctor, that's okay. So it's really relevant to your experience level. Should I have included an objective at the top? Like I said, it's a personal preference. If you do, make it brief. Another thing you can put into your objective instead of doing a cover letter is saying, I'm looking to go into this field, da 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 da. I currently live in XYZ and I'm relocating to Detroit, Michigan. Format, templates, bad idea. Templates can help you streamline your content or give you ideas on how to develop your own format. They're not necessarily a bad idea, but again, just keep it clean and simple. How do I avoid annoying recruiters and hiring managers? Use consistent verb tense, punctuation, spacing. Always have someone proofread your resume. I don't necessarily, because I go through so many resumes, catch typos, but let me tell you, my hiring managers do. And if they're looking for someone for like a data analytical position or an editing position, that is detrimental. You've just lost your chance. Cover letter, yay or nay. I personally do not read cover letters. That's my own personal thing. Again, sometimes it's helpful if you, and a lot, I've seen a lot of people doing this more so lately than not, is including the cover letter with your resume. So it's part of your resume. And again, a cover letter is more so to explain if you're coming from one industry and wanting to make a transition into another, if you're relocating, just anything like that where you need to stand something out. Closer look at Bruce Wayne's resume. What do you see that we just discussed? Again, the bullet points. It's one page. Title is, or the company is bolded, but then the title's right underneath, and then you've got the dates of employment. The education is down here. As I said, you could do education up top or down on the bottom. For interns coming into the workforce or getting an internship, I would put your education up top. What would you do differently? Some of the questions that we can possibly get to. And then finding your right fit. These are some things that you need to ask yourself. What am I really good at? What do I love doing? What do I absolutely loathe doing? Where do I want to go? Why do I want to go there? How can I get there? When do I want to get there? What am I really good at? Example, teaching, fixing problems. What do I love doing? Researching and brainstorming. What do I absolutely loathe doing? Administrative work. Where do I want to go? Senior level leadership. Why do I want to go there? Money and influence. How can I get there? Fast track promotion. By when? My goal is age 35. Sorry, go back. And then that someone else might answer, though, they like proofreading. They like editing. They don't like data analysis. They want to go where their values align, not necessarily a level of a position. And they want to believe in a mission. They want to get there by doing research and networking. And they want to get there by graduation. So not a long-term goal, but more of a short-term goal. Find the job. You want to be as selective as possible. Of course, with internships, apply to as many as you can. If there's multiple types of the same internship title at the company, my recommendation is apply to all of them because they may be under different managers, under different recruiters. You never know where they're going to be. But make sure that you apply to what you want to do. So identify what you want to do and apply to that. Don't just apply to everything from I can be the administrative assistant to I can be a doctor. And then ensure you meet the minimum requirements. Don't let the hiring managers or recruiters have a reason to set your resume aside. If it says that you need a minimum of 1 year, then you need a minimum of 1 year. 1 year can sometimes consist of projects that you've done in school. It can also consist of other interviews. So make sure that you list very relevant experience that you've done, or if you've worked as a TA, things like that. And then tailor your resume based on the qualifications. A lot of interns, I don't think realize that hiring managers are sometimes in a multi-generation position versus yourself. So some of the things that you have just gained in knowledge, we may not have gained over the years or understood that you've gained it. For example, PowerPoint presentations. You may have learned that in high school, but if you don't put that on a resume and the hiring manager states in the departmental summary preferences, excellent PowerPoint skills, you might want to list those things that may seem like the obvious to others, but aren't necessarily the obvious to everyone. Or if you have like SQL skills or things like that. Put your network to work. Utilize your parents, utilize your siblings and your siblings' friends' parents and your friends' parents. And like, for example, my son is in high school, my daughter is in college. This year, we networked with my son's, a couple of the parents on my son's wrestling team because they are both civil engineers. And so she actually got an interview for a civil engineer and then unfortunately COVID happened. So that didn't pan out, but definitely networking everywhere you go. The right job is at the right places, maybe at your right fingertips. Search for jobs on Google and Indeed and Career Builder and Monster. Do your research, check out their websites, read their Glassdoor reviews, follow them on LinkedIn. LinkedIn is also a very good place to put a profile into and get the search links on the jobs on LinkedIn. You can set up where you can put in keywords that are of interest and then you'll get daily jobs sent to you that are put onto LinkedIn. Engage with companies on social media. There's a lot of things, especially on LinkedIn. There's a report that we can run that tells us if someone has a skill set we're looking for, and then we can see if they actually follow us and engage with us on social media. And those might be the first people that we reach out to just because we know that they're interested in us. Consider staffing agencies for contracting roles, especially if you're just recently graduating. We hire a lot of recent graduates, especially in IT roles, that come through contracting. And then the intent of that is to convert them within a 6-month period. And then pick up the phone and call those in your network. Like I said, network all over the place. When it's time to apply, make sure your resume is ready. Have it proofread, have it ready to go. Carve out time to take your application and do your application. It could take 2 minutes up to 60 minutes. Sometimes they're assessment testing. Make sure you're feeling sharp and at your game. Don't come in after you've done all day of classes and you're really tired and then start applying to jobs because you could have to take an assessment and then You may think, oh, I've got this in the bag, but I've had plenty of people that have been in the role and failed the assessment. Review everything carefully before submitting. And then by phone. This is one of my biggest pet peeves ever. Many people do not set up their voicemail box, or their voicemail box is full and they don't realize it. Make sure if you're looking for a job, you set up your voicemail box and make sure it is professional. First name, last name, please leave a message. I'll return your call at my earliest convenience. Make sure you check your voicemail regularly. Make sure, again, that it's not full. Only answer the phone if you're in a good spot to talk. I can be honest with you. I have called some students, especially in this last season, that I'm pretty sure I woke them up. If you're just waking up, don't answer your phone. Let it go to voicemail and come back. Recruiters understand that if it's not the right time, if you're running into class, don't answer your phone. Just wait, let it go to voicemail, call back. But do call back as soon as you can, because like I said, we have hundreds of applicants. So if we're calling you, you're in the top group, and that's the ones we really want to talk to. So make sure you get back with us as soon as possible. Create a separate email address for a professional purpose, like your name at gmail.com, or you can utilize your school email if you're organized enough to do that. But make sure that you have something that you are going to be devoted to looking at to see if an email came in. Check your email daily. Check your spam and junk folders. A lot of stuff that comes through applicant tracking systems will go directly into spam and junk folders for some reason. Gmail is the biggest offender of that. When you're responding, thank the person for the interest and for contacting you. Be sufficient, crisp, clear, and concise. And then communicating your must-dos. Always thank the people when you talk with them for the time they've spent with you, even the recruiter that you've talked to. They're your gatekeeper. Every part of the process is an interview. Your resume is an interview. Talking to the recruiter is an interview. The way that you answer the phone is an interview. So just remember, the interview is not necessarily the only part of the interview. Use specific examples to describe why you're great for the role and how you can add value, reiterate your excitement for the opportunity, and close with suggestive phrases like, I look forward to our next discussion, and triple check your thank you letter before sending it. And then during COVID-19 times, we've all had to adjust, and it's been very, very interesting. And I think a lot of people have become very creative in how they do things. But make sure that you're prepared to do a video interview. At Blue Cross, we do a lot of Skype for Business interviews. It's a free download. Make sure you test that link. Make sure you format prior to the interview. Even prior to doing this, because I have never done a Zoom presentation before, I tested it out with my director and made sure that my lighting was good, my location was good, I dressed professionally. We all are in a different time right now. So the normal workday is not the what it used to be normal workday. Prepare as though you're on an in-person interview and maintain eye contact. Don't stare at your resume or the notes that you have. Try to maintain some eye contact. All right, thanks everyone. Any questions?
Oh man, yes, there are questions. All right, no, I love it. Please keep putting them in. We will get to them. All right, where to start? How do we highlight research papers or accomplishments we've made in our courses? What section should that fall under?
You can put a section that actually is like projects, educational projects, things like that, and add that either right, if you put your degree information up top, maybe you put it right next below that and then put your professional experience below that. Or if you want to do professional experience first and then projects, I've seen it either way.
Okay. So this just came in. Do you have to mention your GPA?
It's a good thing to mention your GPA only because most companies are looking for a 3.0 or better. If you don't have a 3.0, not necessarily a bad thing. We have, like at Blue Cross, one of our requirements is a 3.0 or better. However, we have hired people with a little bit less than a 3.0. That combined would bring them to the table. Or you're working full time. We understand you've got multiple things on your plate. So that could be something that we consider a factor as well.
Okay, so Hope asked, when describing coursework, should we describe all courses or just those that are relevant for the job we are applying for?
I would focus on relevant for the job you're applying for, especially if you're up into your junior, senior year or your master's program, you're going to have a lot more relevant courses to that particular area.
Okay. Christian wants to know, how does a resume for a graduating student looking for first-time, full-time job differ from an internship-seeking resume?
That would be primarily in your objective. I would define it out in your objective. If you're undergrad and you're looking for an intern, I would say XYZ degree, currently pursuing a summer internship or a full year internship. If you're going into just getting out of school, recent MBA graduate or recent IT engineering graduate looking for a career in XYZ, maybe you want to focus on something like cybersecurity, or maybe you want to focus on business if you're an MBA, put that in your objective.
So Austin is transitioning into a new job or looking to transition, fairly experienced in his field and having a difficult time getting his resume seen by recruiters. Any tips that you can give to help land interviews?
So again, put any accomplishments that you've had in the past that especially that might be relevant to the new field that you're looking to transition into, especially if you can put quantitative results. So save $4.6 million by doing this innovative change, anything like that. And then also utilize your objective again. Currently in a talent acquisition, looking to become a human resource business partner.
Okay, so I think I'm going to read this correctly. Segunda asks, I'm trying to decipher this. So basically, if there's a project, how much should you mention that in a resume? Or how much of a project should you mention in a resume?
Yeah, I would mention what the project was and then the results and outcome of and what you contributed to it. So don't be lengthy because again, we look at so many resumes, but get the bullet points out there of this is what the project consisted of. This is what we accomplished. And this is what I was part of.
All right. So we have a software engineer and he or she is interested in knowing what skills are most attractive to you on a resume for a software engineer.
So when you're looking at jobs, look at what they are listing, especially in Blue Cross, we do a lot of generic jobs and a lot of generic titles. So we always ask our managers to try to beef up the title for what you're actually looking for and or put in departmental summary preferences. So if you see a departmental summary preferences on that job listing, look and see what they're asking for. So if they're asking for Java and SQL, then you're going to want to make sure that you get that into your resume. So the keywords are in there. There's a lot of recruiters that do keyword searches and are not to say anything negative about any of my colleagues, but sometimes they don't understand what they're looking for. So they look for keyword searches. And then sometimes, like I've been in the industry for years, so I'm really good at figuring out what they're looking for and getting my managers to tell me in terms so then I can translate it when I look at a person's resume.
Nice. So speaking of, how can someone best describe the outputs of research skills that they have? So, for example, research on a paper, I worked on X project resulting in X.
Yes, and that's it exactly. Quantitative results that you can come up with. So if you did a research project and it ultimately resulted in, we found that if you don't treat symptoms for bronchitis twice when I can't, when a patient is fine after they've taken the Z-Pak, then that cost saved the ultimate industry. So that would be a quantitative result that you could put.
Do you look down at all on small margins for resumes? They put example 0.025 or 0.25. We're getting real specific, but I want to answer these questions.
No, we don't. I mean, as long as it's very clear, simple, and concise is what you want to focus on, not a bunch of squiggly lines and pictures and things like that. And I, another thing I've noticed lately is and maybe Career Resources is advising you to do this, but people will put some information on the left-hand side of the page and then their work experience on the right-hand side of the page. And that's kind of difficult to cross-read. So my preference is just quantitative all the way down, not splitting it up all over the page, because then we get a little confused in reading.
Any other suggestions on font, color, or size?
Arial seems to be the pretty simplest font. Size, the only thing I would say is make your title and your company maybe stand out a little bit more, and maybe your school that you went to, and then underneath it be a little bit smaller in what your degree was. You know, there are some people that have preferences to certain schools. Unfortunately, they have those biases, but they do. And then keep it very, we do a lot of like slants and bolds and things like that, just kind of simple.
Okay. Talking about COVID, and obviously some internships were lost, but I think they're still valued. They earned that internship. They went through the interview process. There's got to be some value there. So what is your thought on keeping it or taking it off? How do you represent a potential lost or rescinded internship due to COVID-19?
Yeah, and I actually was thinking about this earlier today. I would highly recommend you put it on your resume and next to it, due to COVID-19 circumstances, was unable to complete the internship. But at least that shows you obtained an internship, because we interview a lot of interns. And so if you got one of our coveted 160 spots, you earned that. And you went through a lot to get that. So definitely show that you would have had that.
Yeah. So to that point, someone asked, and we've been asked this a lot, so I'd love to hear your feedback. While the virtual intern experience is not a true, like this is not a four credit or anything, a true internship, you know, we've tried to create valuable experiences for everyone, including workshops like this. So someone asked, how would you put the virtual intern experience on a resume?
I would list it as well, that in lieu of not being able to complete my internship, I was offered this opportunity. Companies have paid for this for you. This was not something that was free. So we value you, and we feel the sadness and negativity of this entire COVID-19 experience, but the fact that you've had an experience to be able to do these workshops and list things like that, completed XYZ workshop, networked with XYZ executive. I mean, any of you that got to network with Trisha Keith, her hands are in pots all over the place. So if you get that opportunity to be mentored at all by anyone or networking or anything like that, definitely include that in there, especially through this process.
Valerie, I'll let you know something. There's been some amazing, everyone has been so amazing and gracious with their time. But for example, Trisha was one of our first boardroom sessions. And for those of you tuning in, if you haven't joined a boardroom session, they're incredible. I was explaining it to Valerie earlier. They're a smaller scale session. These are what we deem our workshops, but then boardroom sessions, they're meant to be smaller, they're meant to be more intimate conversations, and on a different platform even, where you can see us, obviously, but then we can actually see you. Right now we can't see you. And in doing that, you can actually ask questions directly of these executives. And Trisha was one of our first, and in it, someone asked an excellent question, and her response was, well, just email me. Here's my email. And I, And I didn't want to call, but I was like, hey, the really smart ones of you just wrote that down super fast.
That's a golden nugget.
They have been dropped. These little nuggets have been dropped throughout our program, and it's you got to be ready, and it's so key. I cannot tell you. It took me a long time to get her email address. And so take advantage of those opportunities, and please tune in, and please go to the lineup, because it happened again yesterday. Managing partner, PwC.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, so they are willing, but you have to tune in. So I appreciate that. That makes it makes us feel valuable, that we know we're putting valuable stuff out, but we would love everyone to put it on their resume, and because it has been a great summer. We'll get to a few more of these, and then we'll let you go. You know, time is valuable. Let me make sure I have no others over here.
And feel free to link in with me and network with me as well. But make sure when you do network with someone, if you have interest in an opportunity specifically, make sure that you include the rec number and the title of the position, because we do have so many positions.
Okay, so this one says, I have a 4-year experience, but after a long gap, I started my education MS and looking for an internship. Should I mention my previous experience?
Oh yeah, definitely, if it's relevant. Definitely mention it. It shows that you've had some professional experience. So,
okay. Should the work experience section be equal to the hobbies and interests section?
No, not necessarily. Focus on the work experience. The hobbies and interests, I wouldn't even put hobbies and interests. I would put more of accomplishments or clubs or things that you've been involved with, especially if you've done volunteerism. That's a huge thing to show. And then in clubs that you've done, it's shown that you've done multi-purpose things or sports that you've played while you've been going to school and accomplishing what you've accomplished. You can multitask.
So speaking of gaps, one of the questions, how do you explain an employment gap in a resume?
And just be honest. If you took time off to be the caregiver of a parent or the caregiver of your children, put that in there. Be honest and just say, gap includes time to raise my children. We're not going to hold that against you.
Perfect. Okay, so we have someone in the military service. Thank you for your service.
Yeah,
how, after my engineering experiences, I want my military service to show on my resume. How? What is a strong way to show without taking emphasis off engineering?
So one of the things that we realized with military resumes is that it's hard for military to translate to out of military, to civilian life. So my recommendation would be to work with the military recruiter and see if they have better ways of helping you translate that information. Because I think there's a lot of stuff that you do in the military that us as civilians don't understand and don't know how to translate it over. So that would be one of my recommendations. And I highly recommend you put it on there, because people love veterans, because we know how devoted you are, how disciplined you are. I mean, there's a lot of traits that we know you bring to the table. So they love it. It's just getting it translated over so we know what you do and what experience you've had.
That's fair. Okay, so we in our previous question that talked about clubs, should we still include clubs on our resume even if we didn't have any leadership roles?
Oh yeah, because it shows you were involved. So you don't necessarily have had to have a leadership role, but you were involved in something.
Okay, back to cover letters. I know you said you don't personally read them, but when should a CV be included in an application? How often is it requested?
So I don't know that, I mean, cover letters are always going to be requested in the applicant tracking system. It's your option to put it in or not put it in, just like your resume, put it in or not put it in, but highly recommend you put in your resume. But cover letters, like I said, a new trend, and I think if you really want to include one, is to put the cover letter with your resume so that when they open up your resume, they see your cover letter first and then the next page is your resume. That seems to be a new trend that I've seen that is much more appetizing for a recruiter and or a hiring manager than having them separate. Less clicks that we have to do while we're looking through things. And again, if you're going to put a cover letter in, make sure. I've also seen where people have put cover letters in and addressed dear Ford hiring manager when they're applying for my positions. Well, clearly I'm not Ford. So make sure you're addressing who you need to address and you're addressing the position you're wanting to address, and or you're utilizing it for something like relocating to the area if you're not from the area, because sometimes people won't look at your candidacy if you're out of state, but if they see relocating to the area, then they know, okay, well, this person's coming here, so we can consider them.
Gotcha. Okay, I know we've talked about font size. Is there any that is too small?
I would try to do like 11 to 14. 10 is starting to get on the too small side. Remember, some of us are older, we're wearing glasses. So, and we look through a lot of resumes, so just make it reader friendly.
I like it. Well, we could go on for all day, I'm sure. I think we've gotten to most, but if we did not get to your question, or if you have further questions, or again, I'm going to give you a little tip here. If you have any interest in Blue Cross Blue Shield as an employer, I would highly recommend, and regardless, you should connect with Valerie. All of our speakers, their LinkedIn pages are connected on our lineup page. So if you go to virtualinternexperience.com/lineup or the lineup tab, you will see all of their names, and that links straight to their LinkedIn page. I highly recommend not only friending them, like, well, I don't even know the terminology, connecting with them, but shoot them a note. Hey, I saw your session on virtual intern experience. I loved it. I learned so much. I just actually, when I was hiding behind the screen, I was responding to several of you sending notes to me. We love it. We love receiving them. It may take a minute to get back to them, but I can tell you that all the speakers will love to hear from you.
And also, feel free to email me at V as in Valerie, Furchi, my first initial last name, at bcbsm.com, and tell me that you heard my presentation and here's some questions you have, or if you have interest in the position, again, include the rec number and the title.
Is it bcbsm.com?
Yep, Blue Cross Blue Shield Michigan, BCBSM.
Okay. For everyone. Again, nuggets, guys. These are golden tickets. So take that. It's in the chat. Luis, I put it right above your comment. It's in the chat. Connect with Valerie and shoot her an email, connect on LinkedIn. Going to our previous conversation, real fast before we close this out, I know we talked about Trisha Keith in our boardroom session. This afternoon and tomorrow, we have two more boardroom sessions along with another workshop tomorrow morning. But today, this afternoon, is Casey Crane. If you are in the business world, especially here in Detroit, they're actually located here in Detroit, Crane's Detroit Business, there's Crane's New York Business, Crane's Chicago Business, Advertising Age, Ad Week, Automotive News. I mean, they have incredible publications all throughout the nation. If you're in business, that's the publication you want to be published in. And if you're a real high achiever, you want to be named one of their 20 in their 20s awards or 40 under 40. He is the leader of that organization. He's a chief operating officer and an incredible guy. So that is an incredible opportunity for you guys to tune in a small, intimate setting. I highly recommend you going online. You should have all received an email this morning with the link to register for that. That's at 1 o'clock this afternoon. Tomorrow, we're talking about how to brand yourself and build your brand and marketing yourself to a better career. That's tomorrow morning. And then in the afternoon, for all of our finance folks or anyone just interested in connecting with amazing people, Allison Waldman is the Chief Financial Officer of Rouge Industries. She's joining us for a boardroom session tomorrow as well. So with that, please go register. Thank you so much, Valerie, for your time, insight today. I hope I don't have to put a resume together anytime soon, but if I do, I appreciate this. And also, people have been asking about recordings. We are recording all of these. We will let you know when they are available and live. I know a bunch of people are interested in your slideshow and the recording. So we'll get that out to you and we'll let you know. Just keep checking those emails and we'll have it out live.
Thank you.
We appreciate everything today.
Yeah. Yeah.